All right, hello again, everyone, and welcome to the Daily Daily Caller podcast, the Friday video edition. I'm Mr. Rourke, your host, Derek Hunter, for the day. And joining me in studio, as you can see, is the one and only Jonah Goldberg. Welcome to the show, Jonah.
It's great to be here. I don't know which camera is technically mine.
So all of them. All. You can have them when you leave. That's part of you coming in, is you get them all.
That's fantastic.
You're our second guest. Grover Norquist was last week, and we went to him, so you're the first person in studio. So if this all goes to hell... we still blame Richie.
Yeah.
Anyway, I wanted to have you in to talk about your new book, Suicide of the West. And we'll get to that in a second. But first, there's breaking news today on this Friday, sad breaking news about Charles Krauthammer.
Yeah.
He has announced to the world that his cancer has returned, and it is very aggressive, and he has only a matter of weeks left to live. And I know that I watch you all the time on the panel with him. I want to get your thoughts on that and about the man.
Yeah, you know, I got the news that about this, I don't know, about 10 days ago. I was telling you before we started, I got it when I was literally at the reception for my father-in-law. And then this guy... at his funeral, right? Yeah. And I get this email from Brett, and it was just such a gut punch. And then when the news came out today, it was a gut punch again. Charles... one of the things people don't understand, and I'm going to avoid talking about him in the past tense, right? Because he's still with us, and I hope that stays the case.
Miracles can happen.
And let's first of all be clear. It's a miracle he's lived this long.
Yes. I mean,
he must be one of the most long-lived quadriplegics ever. And he's lived such a amazing life.
Full life, going to almost every home Nats baseball game.
You could always tell at Special Report that, because I don't follow baseball closely. I don't know when they're home or away and all that kind of stuff. And you could always tell Charles was in a good mood. You always tell there was a baseball game that night because Charles would come in a good mood, sometimes with his baseball cap on, chewing gum, just sort of like cruising around, schmoozing with people because he loved going to baseball. And he loved being on TV, but he loved going to baseball. And
he would just get out of the studio the second the show
turn right
over.
Around. And people don't know, that chair his can cook. I'm serious. I was once at the Republican convention in Tampa. I was walking back from a hotel room at like 6 o'clock in the morning. Nothing nefarious happening. I just crashed at a friend's place because, as I was telling you earlier, my decision tree went awry. And all of a sudden, I hear this buzzing sound, and I'm going over this pedestrian bridge down by the convention center, and I turn around, and all that was missing was Charles blaring. Like Flight of the Valkyrie, because he was like must have been going 20 miles an hour in this in his chair, and you know, one of the things people don't, I mean, Charles is, he has a bit of a Dr. Strangelove persona on TV, right?
But semi Bond villain-esque,
yeah,
but a lovable Bond villain,
yeah, and part of that is out of medical necessity because he has trouble with his breathing, but. Once off camera, a more sort of charming and decent guy you couldn't meet. And he wore his intelligence so unbelievably lightly. I mean, Charles Murray was a close friend of mine who I don't think he would deny is not immune to the charge of a high self-regard for his own intelligence.
Mm-hmm.
Consider Charles Krauthammer literally maybe the smartest person he ever met. And he would tell stories about these IQ tests that he would do. There's one great story, he told it on my podcast once, where he and a nationally ranked chess champion and Charles Krauthammer were driving on the Jersey Turnpike to Madison Square Garden for a chess championship, because they're that cool.
And chick magnets back in the day.
And you know, Krauthammer drove. He has this tricked-out panel van,
right?
And he uses his one semi-good hand to drive fast. He likes to drive fast. And Krauthammer says to Murray, "Hey, you do all this IQ stuff. You know, give us some game that we can play, whatever." And I don't remember how the game exactly works. It's like you get read a series of two-digit numbers, and then you have to repeat them forward and then backward, or something like that. And a good score is like 4 or 5, and Krauthammer would get like 16 or something like that. I mean, he was just an unbelievably well-read, brilliant guy, and is, I should stop it, and You know, we're not going to see his like again.
No, I have just a really quick, amusing to me story. Because when I was growing, before I got to know everybody, I would watch people on TV, and I'd see Krauthammer sitting there. I love Special Report. I've always loved Special Report. Britt Hume, I emailed him while in college, snarkily as a joke, and he wrote me back this really serious email, and I had to apologize to him. So I just guessed at his email address.
Yeah.
But I always thought, why doesn't Krauthammer sit up straight? He was a quadriplegic, and he kind of reminded me of the William F. Buckley sort of shabby chic, leaning, you know. And then I found out, it was like, I felt really bad, but when I met him, he was couldn't have been nicer.
Oh,
he was an incredibly nice man.
Incredibly generous guy, but that was one of the things. Like I'd seen him around town for 20 years before I started doing Special Report, and it was only until I was actually on set with him regularly that I realized, because I was just, okay, so he was in a wheelchair, but like, you know, the stagehands would have to bring a glass with a straw in it and hold it to his mouth because he couldn't lift the glass.
Yeah.
And for him to have no bitterness, no rancor, and go through his life sort of really being a truly happy warrior was this amazing thing. He also had this superpower. You know, at National Review, we used to do this thing in the Corner blog, in our blog, The Corner, where we would have Krauthammer's take, right? And we would just take the transcript of one of his answers from Special Report. And one of the most amazing things was that they needed no editing. And as you know, like most like transcripts of natural speech, they're not...
People start sentences and stop them, start over.
They're not grammatically correct. They have these weird tangents. I mean, if you ever read John Kerry's transcripts, it sounded like he was having a stroke, right?
And Barack Obama off teleprompter.
Yeah, yeah. And crowd numbers were grammatically perfect, organized, topic sentence straight through. And it dawned on me, you know, the guy hadn't typed in 50 years. He's been dictating all of his columns. You know, if you ask me, because I write, I don't know, 5,000 words a week or something, to type you a quick paragraph on what I think, mine would be cleaner than most normal people's just because I type all the time.
Right.
He's been dictating with his crazy organized mind his copy for his entire life, both medical stuff and punditry stuff and everything in between. And so he had this gift where on Special Report, you could ask him an out of left field question. He just had this perfectly organized oral paragraph that he just put up there. But I know it's...
In a way, it's kind of good that we know now because so many people pass and we don't get a chance to have people tell their thoughts so the person can actually hear it.
No, that's right. That's the only upside of this is that, you know, I think there's going to be a real outpouring of appreciation for the guy.
Now I want to turn to a much cheerier subject. The Suicide of the West is Jonah Goldberg's book, How the Rebirth of Tribalism, Populism, Nationalism, and Identity Politics is Destroying American Democracy. I didn't hold up my copy because I put a protective coating on it already.
It's very nice.
I
thought you stole it from a library.
I have like 1,000 book library at home of signed books.
Uh-huh.
And so anyway, that's neither here nor there. I want to start with the end or near the end.
Yeah.
And talk about it's in the appendix here, but it's sort of your summation.
Mm-hmm.
We are living in an unnaturally prosperous time. Our prosperity is not merely material, but political and philosophical. We live in a miraculous time, and that's a theme that comes up a lot. And that's what I don't want to sit here and read the whole time.
Mm-hmm.
I want to have you talk to the audience about the miracle that you reference in here, because the first line in the book is there is no God in this book.
Right.
But then you hear miracle, you think, what are you talking about? Tell us about the miracle you're referring to.
Right. So, first of all, the reason I say there's no God in this book is not because I'm an atheist. I'm not an atheist. What I'm trying to do is make an argument that doesn't appeal to some either Marxist idea of cold and personal forces making something inevitable or to divine providence making something inevitable. Part of my argument is that modernity, however you want to define it, liberal democratic capitalism, the miracle, the Enlightenment. We can talk about the Enlightenment in a second because there's a lot of dumb things being written right now about the Enlightenment. But it's not natural. We stumbled into this thing. And the reason why I call it a miracle isn't because it's divine, although I don't care if people want to argue that it's divine. My point is I'm trying to persuade people who don't think appeals to God matter or have any power. It's a miracle in part because, first of all, we don't really know why it happened, right? There's no consensus about why it happened. There is a consensus that it happened. There's a consensus among economic historians, anthropologists, sociologists, whatever, that for 250,000 years, the average human being everywhere in the world lived on no more than $3 a day. Ancient Rome, ancient China, whatever, right? And then basically once and only once in human history, starting about 300 years ago, it starts to go like this, starting in England, spreading to Western Europe, then coming to America, and spreading around the globe ever since. And for the first time in human history, notions of the sovereignty of the individual, human liberty, but also just raw material prosperity. You know, man's natural environment is a short life punctuated by an early death, either from disease, some bowel-stewing disease, or violence, right? Mm-hmm. And then that all starts to change miraculously. And if you look at the world that we've created in just the span, basically, of six lifetimes, it's like we went through some Narnian wardrobe thing into a different world. It's not a perfect world. It wasn't instantaneously perfect when it started to happen, but it happened nonetheless, and we should be grateful for it.
So your thesis is that the natural state of man is different than where we find ourselves right now because of sort of a divine accident through the Protestant work ethic of postponed payoff suddenly sprang wealth.
Right. So when I say it's an accident, what I mean is that no one planned this, right? And so the Protestant work ethic thesis, which is very popular and I think has a lot of explanatory value, I don't think it really does the job that people want it to do. Even Max Weber, who coined it, kind of abandoned it a few years later. But the thesis, the sort of crude popular version of it, is that Puritanism, Calvinism, whatever, Protestantism, it came up. There was this argument that came forth that said, if you behave a certain way, that will be a possible indicator that you're more likely to get into heaven, right? And it wasn't to get rich. Mm. It was, this is how to get right with God. And
work hard, help others, things like that.
Work hard, help others, delayed gratification, thrift, right? All of these kinds of things, honest dealings. And it turns out that the more you embrace those values, the more likely it is you're going to be a successful businessman, right? You know, if you honor your contracts and all that kind of stuff. And so even by, my point is, even though by the Max Weber thesis of the Protestant work ethic, it was an accidental byproduct, right? This wasn't the plan to get rich.
Protestantism wasn't created.
Right, that's the prosperity gospel, which is a very different thing, right? And part of my argument, which is, again, getting lost by a lot of people who don't understand parts of the book, is that this wasn't, I call it the Lockean revolution after John Locke, but I'm pretty explicit that John Locke didn't create it. He's a good stand-in for it. He represents this fundamental transformation of the mindset of people on the ground, that they started behaving differently. They started looking at things like innovation as a good thing. For most of human history, all around the world, innovation was viewed very suspiciously, so was commerce. But innovation, you know, in Western Europe was considered a sin, the sin of curitas, questioning the established order. For thousands of years, aristocrats, guilds, monarchs, and priests had a closed system that said no one can question the established order. And then boom, for some weird reason, in places like Holland and England in the 1600s, 1700s, that started to change, and all of a sudden, innovation, creativity, commerce, these were things to celebrate. And John Locke represents that change of mind, and I'm sure I have no problem saying he contributed to it, but he didn't create it. This was a ground-up, weird thing that happened, and one of the reasons it could work in England, and it happened in England, and again, the English didn't plan it. It has to do with the weirdness of English culture as a historical anomaly. And so the reason why I go into all of this is that we stumbled into this thing that comes out of English culture, not as a bunch of abstractions. The abstractions come out of the culture. And the great thing that the Founding Fathers did was write this crap down and lock it in. And then America takes off. And so for me, it's like the goose that lays the golden egg, right? The goose that lays the golden egg waddles into your house and promises to squeeze out basically more wealth than you could possibly imagine. And, you know, in the story that we hear about the goose that lays the golden egg, the people, in one version of it, the guy demands that he wants two golden eggs, and the goose politely says, I can't do that for you. And And the guy gets so mad at it, he strangles it and kills it, right? In another version, these two sort of super rational people get a golden egg, goose lays a golden egg, and they deduce through their like Paul Krugman-like genius that they can dissect the goose and find a bigger lump of gold inside, and so they kill it, right? The moral of the story we're supposed to get is it's about greed, and that's fine if you want to call it greed, but the more important and relevant one is it's ingratitude. If a goose came into your life and started grapping out winning lottery tickets, Powerball tickets, you'd say thank you. You'd protect it. You'd honor it. You'd give it a really great pillow.
Or I'd keep 10 of them and then sell it.
Yeah, or whatever. But you would understand its value.
Oh, yes.
Right? And instead, we live in a culture right now where we teach people to be outraged. We teach people to be resentful. We teach people to be entitled. Entitlement and resentment are the opposite of gratitude.
Well, there was a time when you'd walk down the street with your kid and you'd see somebody drive by in a Rolls Royce or Maserati or some rich car, and the kid goes, "Ooh, look at that car." And he says, "You, Junior, you can have a car like that too,
right,
if you work hard one day." Now, the parent turns to the kid and says, "Grab a rock, throw it at that SOB. He doesn't deserve it because we don't have one."
Right.
And you have, in your conclusion, the decline is a choice.
Right.
You talk about the enemy within. You quote John Courtney Murray. Mm-hmm. I'm going to bastardize this quote mostly because I don't want to read again on the show.
I know reading's hard for you.
I do have dyslexia, and I did forget my glasses, so there's a double whammy. But he talks about the enemy within. The real problem is not communism. It's the idiot. Now, it's not an idiot, somebody talking to a tree or somebody who can't put their pants on at one time. Tell us what that means about the idiot, because when you describe it, I think people will know a lot of idiots.
So, yeah. Idiot has the same, it's a Greek word, and it comes from, it has the same root as like idiosyncratic, and it means someone who sort of stands apart. And the idiot in ancient Greece wasn't a fool. He could be very smart. He was just someone who had made no investment in being a good citizen, no investment in the greater good of their society or their community, and simply tried to grab what was theirs and didn't do their homework about what it meant to be a productive member of society and a decent person and a citizen. And that's, I think we have a pretty sizable outbreak of both kinds of idiocy. But I think that's a big part of our problems these days, is that partly out of choice in terms of how we educate people, what kind of values we communicate through popular culture and whatnot, we are teaching people just to look out for what is theirs and
be angry about what isn't theirs.
And be angry about what isn't theirs, right? I mean, so the analogy I keep using is, remember the movie Goldfinger?
Yes.
Right. So in Goldfinger, Goldfinger's great plan wasn't to rob Fort Knox.
It was to destroy the gold.
It was to irradiate the gold, with make it radioactive so no one could use it or bring it to market for like 10,000 years or something like that, thus making
his gold
stockpile so much richer, right? The way people like Howard Zinn and other people on the left teach American history is they say it's purely a story of victims, of terrible things that America did to these deserving, noble people of the sort of coalition of the oppressed. And what they want to say is that's the only history you can teach, right? So I have no problem pointing out the bad things Christopher Columbus did. I very much want to teach that slavery was evil. But I want to teach those things to point out how we overcame our problems and became a better country. They want to say that we're defined by those
things. Not even that they want to say we're defined by them. They overhype them. They act as though nobody would have realized that there was another half of the planet.
Right.
And eventually diseases would have come over here and wiped out. It's not anybody alive's fault that people happen to advance more quickly in Europe and be able to build the capacity to come over here. And that brings us to the question of the Enlightenment, which you referenced earlier. There is a lot of stupidity going on around the Enlightenment. I just want to read one tweet from Jamel Bowie, who I believe sort of kicked off the latest round of stupidity about the... I hope so, because that would mean there are more people out there if he wasn't the one who started it. To put it bluntly, racism is an Enlightenment idea whose foundations were laid by key thinkers like Locke and Kant.
Yeah, so I'm going to write a big piece about this for National Review, and, you know, for reasons that kind of baffle me, Jamel really has a problem with me, even though we were both civil with each other in green rooms and whatnot. I'm willing to sort of split the baby on this. I think it's absolutely true that some notions of biological racism appear or come out of some Enlightenment thinkers back then. I mean, I can, you know, Johann Fichte.
It can also come from, you know, if you're a guy in, sitting in Paris or London in the 1600s, you've never seen anybody different from you.
Right.
Or maybe once or twice at some royal gathering, but otherwise it doesn't exist. So if somebody comes in from Africa, no matter how advanced they happen to be at the time, and they're wearing loincloths, and you're wearing 15 layers of clothing with a starched collar, it's going to seem different to you. And your way in your mind is always the best. So that it's not necessarily racism in the sense of I'm better than you because you're black. It's more of a you're different, and I look at what you do as inferior. Not
right.
Because
well,
of
but
your
so
skin
so so my point is, first of all, you know, I'm not going to defend Kant. Kant said some dumb things, but you know, John Locke, you know, he wrote explicitly that slavery was this moral horror and that it was only acceptable as an alternative to death. Right. And he's talking about it in the abstract, but his writings had a lot to do with destroying the notion that some people are better than other people simply by accidents of their birth. He was did great violence to notions of nobility, divine right, and kings, and all that kind of stuff. But where I think Jamel and a lot of other people get wrong is, and I'm not even going to go into romanticism, but even if you want to take Jamel's hard case, or strong version of his case, and say that racist ideas were invented by Enlightenment thinkers, fair enough, or fine. I'm okay with stipulating it, even though I don't think it's really true. The simple fact is that bigotry, right, of whatever form, is as old as man.
Yes.
We are hardwired to have distrust of others. We are hardwired to see my tribe is good and your tribe is evil. The amount of social science that has been done on this is just utterly dispositive on it. Paul Bloom at Yale wrote a wonderful book called Just Babies, where he surveys the social science literature, or the neuroscience literature, on the wiring that babies inherit at birth. And, you know, so babies almost instantly associate with the ethnic type of their parents. Mm-hmm. And then they distrust people of a different ethnic type. Babies cry in language-specific accents, and they're attracted to from birth almost, they are attracted to languages that they heard in utero and find other languages to be scary and off-putting. So, and this was an adaptive evolutionary trait, because you needed social cooperation among tribes or bands or platoons, whatever you want to call them, in order to pass on your genes. Darwin writes about this, about how a tribe that really works closely together and is cooperative and altruistic towards one another is more likely to defeat and destroy a neighboring tribe that is a bunch of full of Randian individuals, right? And so this us versus them thing is in our DNA. And this is one of the reasons why I hate this phrase, people have to be taught to hate. No, people have to be taught not to hate. The software we're born with tells us to hate or distrust at the very least. And that's what civilizations do, is they teach you that your gut instincts may not be right. And they bring you up about a sense of principles that bring you out of this us versus them tribalism. And so to say that the Enlightenment invented racism, I kind of want to say, even if it were true, so friggin' what? Because the larger and more important point is that the racism stuff was just a tiny chapter in the long history of tribes killing other tribes and being bigoted against other peoples and ethnicities. I mean, you read the Bible, a lot of people are killing each other, you know, the Hittites versus the, you know, Sumerians, whatever. If you want to say that wasn't racism, fine, but it was bigotry. It was this ethnocentrism thing, and the racism stuff that allegedly, and I don't think it really does, comes out of the Enlightenment, it's just sort of a rounding error on that much larger historical narrative.
And the Enlightenment led to the abolition of slavery.
Well, that's the important part.
You can't forget that. You can hate the oak, or the acorn, but the tree that grew from it.
That's absolutely right. And that's a big part of the thesis of my book, is that you know people want to say the founding fathers were hypocrites because they said this stuff about all men being created equal, but they didn't believe it. They had slaves. They didn't treat women. Blah 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 blah, and I'm perfectly willing to grant it was hypocritical. But the glorious thing about hypocrisy is that hypocrisy illuminates an ideal. You can't be, if you have no principles, you can't be a hypocrite, right? Mm-hmm. And the beauty of the Enlightenment and particularly the Scottish and British Enlightenments. You know, my general, remember Mike Myers, and So I Married an Axe Murderer? When it comes to Enlightenments, if it's not Scottish, it's crap, as far as I'm concerned. But it's this kernel of an idea that unfolds over time. And so every meaningful civilization for the last 10,000 years since the Agricultural Revolution had slavery. What is interesting about Western civilization isn't that we had it, but that we got rid of it. And the reason we got rid of it is because of these ideas that were inherent in Christianity, inherent in the Enlightenment, were allowed to unfold to their logical moral conclusion. And to say the Enlightenment is responsible for all of these evil things, the first question you have to ask is, compared to friggin' what? You know, I mean, in China today, if you could make the Chinese into blue-eyed Swedes and say the Uyghurs or the other non-Han ethnic Chinese into blacks, it would be instantly recognizable as Jim Crow over there. You can't get an internal passport if you're not Han Chinese. You can't get into certain universities. You can't get certain jobs, all because the majority Chinese are outrageously racist. But we have this blind spot to it because we think racism and even slavery is an American invention.
Well, right.
That's just garbage.
Well, it's because the people espousing it are here, and we're the shining light. With all our flaws, we're still what most people in this world aspire to.
Right.
And that has to be destroyed. The light has to be extinguished before the rest of the tribalism. All right, last question here on the book. Tribalism, populism, nationalism, identity politics, mm-hmm. they're all different branches of the same tree, but which one should we be most afraid of or most concerned about, at least at this moment?
You know, I would probably narrow it down to, basically all of these are forms of tribalism.
Right.
Right? And so, I mean, the subtitle is in partly a...
But they're used differently.
They have different valences. They manifest themselves differently. I would say, you know, the two ones that vex me the most are populism and identity politics. And I think populism is a bigger problem for conservatives these days, and identity politics is the central problem for liberals.
It's funny to me watching the left destroy itself with the monster it created, because Frankenstein's monster always returns to the castle. When Google changes their emoji for salads,
yes,
to remove the egg to make it vegan friendly, when you'd need a jeweler's loop to see it in the first place, you
right.
wouldn't even know it was there. You know, we've reached maximum insanity.
Well, also, if there is a vegan out there whose day is ruined because there's a slice of hard-boiled egg in his friggin' salad emoji.
Is there an exchange via text where you think, God, if only I had an emoji of a salad, I can't express myself fully unless I can have this emoji of a salad?
No, I like to think that there's some woman out there that was this close to wanting to marry a dude until he texted a picture of a salad with a hard-boiled egg slice in it. And even though the guy is probably also a vegan, right? But just the insensitivity of having this aborted chicken fragment in their salad emoji is what, you know, like, well, it's out of my hands. Can't marry this guy.
Oh, no, if it was aborted, they'd be fine with it. It didn't get to that stage. So they're unhappy with it. So the book, Suicide of the West, How the Rebirth of Tribalism, Populism, Nationalism, and Identity Politics is Destroying American Democracies. Jonah Goldberg is columnist for LA Times,
and
USA Today, Fox News contributor, editor at large now at National Review,
senior editor
of NRO. You at the American Enterprise Institute. If you don't have a job out there, it's either because you don't want to work or he took it. It's really to that point. Jonah, thank you for coming in. I'm going to ask you to sign all of these copies.
I can do that.
And I'm going to give one, depending on who claims what, possibly two people an opportunity to win one of these. Just email Derek, D-E-R-E-K, at dailycaller.com. I'll pick at random. If you want to send me some PayPal money, that can help tip the scales. But I appreciate you coming in. Thank you so much.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.
And I found this when I worked in the United States Senate. It's a Mont Blanc pen.
Very nice.
Somebody left it at security, and the guards liked me. I was smoking at the time,
uh-huh.
and I got to know them because I was in and out all the time. And they said, I saw the pen. I'm like, that's a nice pen. I said, you can have it. So they're like, wow, I've got a Mont Blanc pen.
Very nice.
So
maybe this is one of the ones that Bob Dole carried around.
Maybe it did. Is there blood on it? Because I suspect he stabbed people. This was back in 2006, so he wasn't around anymore.
No, I guess he wasn't around.
But people don't destroy evidence. Anyway, the book is out now. It's a big New York Times bestseller. Congratulations
on that.
And it's a very thick book. It's a lot of research. I was looking at the notes.
There's a lot of notes.
About 100 pages of footnotes on there. So it took you about 2 years, 3 years to write this?
More than three, yeah.
So the next one's going to be out in 6 months?
I don't know.
What are you waiting for?
I feel like Roy Scharter and Joyce, too, you know, saying, that's a shark, and as God is my witness, I'm not going through that hell again.
You don't really like writing books.
I hate it, yeah.
Because it does take so
long. It's work,
yeah. I just spent 6 months to 8 months on this thing, and it's not even out yet.
I have my copy at home.
You got a copy?
Yeah, I got a copy.
Good, I was going to give you a copy, but now forget it. All right, thank you for coming in. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to subscribe to wherever the subscribe button is. This is the Daily Caller podcast. We'll be back here on Monday. Have a good one.